A few announcements, and I do mean a few. We're really scraping the barrel for things because it's just the dead of summer, but you'll see the sum total of the announcements up here. Starting today, in about 3 hours, we're going to be on the road, heading up to a cabin in northern Minnesota for a youth getaway. Please be in prayer for that. There's a few things that I've put on the insert for if you are inclined to pray for us. We appreciate that. If you're inclined to join us, just come up for a day or so to just kind of crash and see what this is about. You're more than welcome. We've got plenty of food. We've got room as well. And don't just think, well, it's just a youth trip. Don't worry about it. Please come and join us. We'd love to have you. You'll see here too the men's Bible study on Tuesday. And then I believe this is the last normal game for softball before we get into playoffs. We've been doing pretty good. I think so. We usually walk away with at least one win, so we're looking pretty good. So if you'd like to come to those games, the time is there as well. I did want to put on your radars as well. August 14th is Alternative Transportation. So, oh, there is a slide for that. Laura, you did put that on there. So Alternative Transportation, Chuck, I'm sure you've been working on your ideas for the last year. So just so you know, that's going to be at Zion's Harpsburg at 10:30 as well. The call to worship this morning is from Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's pray as we begin our worship service. Lord, we thank you for the chance to be able to come and worship you today. We pray that you would speak to us through our time together, a fellowship that we have. Lord, the music, but also the time in your word, especially that. Lord, we pray that you would bless us and that this time would be yours, that your name would be lifted up. And we pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to do two praise songs as we begin our service, and the words will be up on the screen for you today.
Thank you. feel better, and also Corky, Mark, and Bonnie as well.
We'll pray for Corky and Bonnie as well as Nina. Yeah, Bill.
Praise God for the continued rain and then this beautiful weather today. And then pray for Dodie as well, too. Her back is bothering her again this morning. So.
We'll pray for Dodie as well. And also, yeah, the thankfulness of the rain. More on the forecast. You know, a year ago, remember? Mm-hmm. Desperate for any rain in the forecast. It was just nothing but sun. And thankful for God's provision as well. Chuck, you had?
Yeah. Praise for last Sunday. Mm-hmm. Good time we had here. Also, continue to pray for my friend Leon. Pray for strength for him and his wife.
Yeah, we'll continue to pray for Leon.
Also, another praise just for all those that worked so hard on that event last week.
Absolutely.
Quite a group of you that put all that together, so thank you.
Quite a group. We were just seeing the feedback from that and just the appreciation of people celebrating with us that milestone. So, yeah, thank you to everybody who's been a part of that. Carrie, you had?
Praise God for music. We can praise Him in song.
I just love keeping God close in my heart and my mind. Keeps me going great. And I love being here.
Thanks for the testimony. Yeah, thank you, Linda.
Thank you.
Let's join together in prayer. Lord, as we've already said, this is the day that you've made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. Lord, you do provide for us abundantly, more than we ask or think. And Lord, as we reflect on your provision and the answers to prayer that we have, and the season of thankfulness, Lord, especially considering this last week, we are thankful, Lord, for the work that you're doing in our midst, in our own hearts, and in the hearts of the people around us. We thank you for the fellowship we have. Be able to come here today and to just rest. Lord, we recognize that you do more than we often recognize or realize. So we give you thanks for those things as well. Lord, as we continue to rely on you for all things, we do turn to you in prayer as you invite us to, Lord, and as you welcome us to pray, Lord, that tells us that you are willing to listen, and that you do listen and you do answer in your own way. And Lord, we thank you for the answers to prayer. We thank you for the rain that we've been getting. We're thankful for the chance to be able to worship you freely here. And how we do that through these different parts of our service, through the music, through time in your word. Lord, we would pray that you continue to strengthen us during this time as well. We do pray for healing, Lord, for many of our people. We think of Anita and Corky especially today, and Dodie with her back. And then Leon, Lord, as we continue to lift up these people to you, we know that you already care more for them than we ever could. So we leave them in your care, Lord, and we pray rather humbly for healing for all of them. Lord, we pray for them as well as they continue to make decisions. As they are in the throes of it, Lord, sometimes it feels like you're just taking your time. And we can get frustrated, and sometimes we don't even want to pray because what's the point? But you would still invite us and encourage us, even in times like that, to rely more fully on you. So that is what we would do today. We pray for our nation today, Lord, and would pray first off for revival. As we reflect on the great need that people have for you, we would pray that you'd start that revival in our own hearts. Refresh us through time in your word. Lord, remind us of what you have done for us in Jesus. And Lord, help us to be the bearers of that message to a world that's just desperate for any kind of realistic hope or peace. Lord, we would pray for those that are governing us today as well, those who are leading us, and we ask for wisdom. We pray for wisdom already as we prepare for midterms and the primary coming up. We ask for wisdom for us as voters, and Lord, we lift up those that are leading right now as well, and we pray especially for them too. Well, we can think about those that are serving our of mind for them today as well. As we continue our service, Lord, we do appreciate the time to be able to pray together, to support one another with the needs that we have. And Lord, as we have this chance, Lord, we would also take this time and confess our sins before you. Says that there's now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. We claim that promise as well as the others that continue to remind us that our sins are forgiven because of what Jesus has done for us. Remind us of that, Lord, when we doubt or when we start to question or when we're really feeling discouraged. Remind us and refresh us in that promise. Lord, we ask and pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to stand together as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, page 1094, or you can find it on the screen in front of you. Let's read God's word together. On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret. And he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep, and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and the nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken, and also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. This is God's word. You may be seated. For the message this morning, let's sing together 262. At the time. As he writes this to his friend Theophilus, what happens here is bringing them into a completely new life. And it's a little funny. Like, this story is a little funny. As you take a look at the interaction of Simon Peter, who doesn't know Jesus yet, and Jesus, who does know Simon Peter, and the other soon-to-be disciples that are going to be helping Simon with this catch of fish. Like, through this, I wonder if Jesus just sits back like, this is classic Simon. This is exactly something that he's going to do. Yeah, he would say that. Just wait, oh wait, here it comes, and then here comes the fish, boom, right? And you just kind of watch this interaction between Simon and Jesus. And what's happening here is more than just a miracle, right? The point of this passage, as we're looking at this, is that the greater lesson that we're looking at is obedience to Jesus. We're looking at the impact of what it is to follow Jesus, to be actually having him as the Lord of your life. And the interaction here with Simon, as he doesn't know Jesus, is one where he learns this lesson, but then turns and drops everything that he has and goes and follows his new Lord. Who's the master in this story? Let me ask this. Who is the master in this account? It's a Sunday school answer, guys. Who is the master? It's Jesus. Who's the master fisherman? It's still Jesus, right? But Simon does this for a living. What does Jesus do for a living up to this point?
Carpenter?
Yeah, he's a carpenter. He's a craftsman. He works with raw materials. He makes stuff, right? You're not a fisherman. Like, I do this for a living, right? Simon Peter has the permanent station of the night shift. And we talked about this when we looked at John, after Easter, when we looked at John 21, where this same miracle happens again, same lake, same boats, same people. And what happens here is that they go fishing at night so that the fish don't see the nets. And during the daytime, you're not going to catch anything. That's just the way it is. It's your try. That's not what's going to happen. What happens here is that Peter and co. have the most experience by a mile for fishing. Humanly speaking, Simon doesn't know Jesus. He's just this pop-up rabbi who happens to be there on the shore trying to teach a lesson. And people are crowding in on him. And every time the Bible starts talking about the crowds pressing up against Jesus, what I tend to think of is the State Fair, right? Minnesota State Fair, or going to Twins games at the Metro. Right? When you're trying to get through, the game's over, you're trying to basically do this through the doors, that wind, that gust of wind comes through and knocks your hat off kind of deal. That's what I imagine what happens when. So Jesus is being pressed in on, and he sees two boats. Luke says there's two boats here, and there's fishermen cleaning their nets. Doesn't necessarily say whose they are. And Jesus picks one of the boats and says, let's go. Do you think this is just chance? A 50-50 chance that maybe this is this boat, maybe it's not? Or do you think he picks Simon's boat on purpose? I think he does. I think he picks Simon's boat on purpose and says, please bring us out a little bit and into the lake so I can teach the people, because they're pressing in on me. We're in lake country now. Last Wednesday we took the kids, students for youth group up to Zorbin's. I mean, just a perfect night. Nice and warm, nice cool, barely any wind, just enough to keep the bugs off, nice and sunny. And, you know, boats driving past, and I'll tell you, I don't know how far those boats were out, but you could listen to basically any radio station you wanted if you were there long enough, because you can hear across the water really well. And that's what's happening. Jesus gets into this boat, and he starts to teach. No word on what he teaches, but then he goes and says, Simon, I have an idea. Let's go out into the deeper water. Like, all of a sudden, Jesus is chartering a cruise on the lake. And he says, let's go fishing. You got all this stuff. Your nets are relatively clean. And right after doing all of this, he said, let's go. And Simon Peter, the master, we're going to pause there. This is in verse 5, if you're still following. Master, does Simon mean it? Or is he just being polite? I think he's just being polite because he recognizes as Jesus, as a guy who's just taught this lesson, he's a rabbi, he's one who's teaching from the law of Moses. And out of respect for what you do, I will call you master. But he doesn't believe it. Right? Master, quote unquote. Master, we toil all night. Like, read between the lines. I want to go to bed. I'm really frustrated because I didn't catch anything. And that doesn't matter if you're a hobbyist fisherman, like my grandpa, who would put a line in with no bait on it. Right? He doesn't care if he catches anything or not. Simon's livelihood depends on him catching fish. Simon is frustrated and says, I just want to go to bed. I just want to go in. Our nets were clean. I don't want to get them dirty. But at your word, we'll do what you say. In other words, he's saying, since you asked so nicely, we will humor you. Guys, and then he turns to his crew, and you can about, Luke doesn't record this, but he turns to the crew that he has, and it's his brother Andrew, and says, all right, let's do it. Do what he says. Put the nets in. Roll, probably I roll. And what happens here, we know what happens. There is, and when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish. It wasn't like, and then they waited for about half an hour. When they threw the net in, I'm imagining that as soon as the net had settled down, after it had kind of gotten into place, all the weights had pulled it down to the full extent, then it filled with fish. Keep in mind here that now on commercial fishing boats, we have winches to pull up those nets. These guys, maybe they have some pulleys, but they are using their arms. These guys are probably wrapped. They're super strong because they're hauling this net full of fish through the water, and now this net is so full that it's breaking. Anybody fish like this? No? I empathize with Simon Peter in this. There was a point where, I think I've shared this story. We were dating still. We weren't even engaged, but we went to the Boundary Waters. And I'm an okay fisherman, and the Boundary Waters is the kind of place that you can go and catch fish even if you're the worst fisherman out there. How long was it? How many days? It was days. I had not caught a single thing. Everybody, I was right in between lines. And I was moving around, trying different things, trying different hooks, trying everything. I could not catch a single fish. It eventually got to the point where I went to use the facilities in the woods and came back and I had a fish on. Well, what had happened was when I was away, her cousins caught a fish, put it on my line, and put it back in the lake. Right? This is the kind of fishing trip I'm having. And as soon as I grab the rod, it's off the hook. It jumps off. Exactly. That was what, and we put that on. It's like, okay, well now I feel disrespected and now I'm just, I guess, along for the ride. Here we go. And I get what happens here. Because all of a sudden, we're trolling along, I told the story, yes? Okay, whatever. We're trolling along a ledge of rocks. I'm in the front, line out, she's in the middle, her dad's in the back, and I catch a bass. On my own. Proving that I somewhat know what to do. And I'm reeling it in, and all of a sudden, Muskie comes up and eats that fish. And what's going through my mind is like, all right, it's not so much about quantity as it is quality. Like, look at this. If I come back with this huge fish, it will more than make up for the deficit for the last week. Well, the line didn't break, but that fish did. Muskie did spit out that bass. I get what it's like, though, to be able to try all the time and not catch anything. And here Simon is hauling in this huge catch of fish from the commands of this guy who he's just called master, and has rather, not necessarily disrespectfully, but not seriously taken into consideration who is in his boat. Remember, Simon doesn't know who Jesus is. But now he's starting to realize the kind of guy he has. Not just this pop-up rabbi. Not just this craftsman. Maybe there's something more going on with this man. And in all of this, we reflect on the role here of how disciples are made. And how they're called to be disciples in the first place. What will happen is that the Jewish people will go through school and they'll learn the law of Moses. These are the laws by which we govern our land. And they will learn to follow them and they'll memorize like books entire books. And by the time they finish school, there's a cutoff point where everybody else that's not like the best, like if you're a certain GPA or higher, like if you've really taken an aptitude to studying God's word, you can keep going on to school. All the rest of you go out and apprentice with whatever your dad did. Right? And that's where Jesus' disciples are at. They're doing all of this with their, this is the family business. The best of the best, now, so then this, you've got this other group that continues to study, and the best of the best of this group will then have an opportunity to go out to other rabbis, people and respected teachers that they want to follow, and they as students will come up to the teacher and say, can I be your disciple? And then at that point, it's up to the teacher to decide whether or not he can take on another disciple. If they want, and we look at this whole resume of this person and see, like, oh, I see you studied under this person, and I see that, you know, all this, and they would decide whether or not this student was worthy enough to be a disciple of theirs. Because being a disciple meant more than just listening to the teachings of this person. It was more than just trying to apply that teaching to your life. Being a disciple meant that you are going to try and copy the life pattern of that teacher. You are going to basically copy, paste. That is what you are going to be. And if here's Jesus, what is he doing? As the rabbi, going to the first group of people, the people who didn't make the first round of the draft, right, the cutoff, they go to this group of, he goes to this group of people and says, come follow me. People that never thought they had a chance to be a disciple, to continue growing in that kind of educational status. Come be my disciples, come follow me. This is what Simon Peter is now realizing. And he's caught off guard in surprise, which I think leads us to suspect that he's not serious, at least initially, that Jesus is actually a master. He uses the word, but he doesn't believe it. Because when Jesus is the master, when Jesus is Lord, and you believe that, and you live like that, you're not surprised when your boat is filled with fish. It's not surprising when astonishing, miraculous, unbelievable things happen. Because that's just what happens when Jesus is in charge. Simon Peter comes to this realization, and through this undeniable miracle, as the net starts to break, they call out to the other boat. And guess who's in that boat? James and John. Their dad is right there. They're not too far off from shore, so they call out, like, help! And they row out, like, what's going on? Oh my goodness! And they start hauling up as well. And this boat, that as the nets are breaking, the boats are filling with so much fish that they're starting to sink. Have you ever been in a boat that's starting to sink? Somebody forgot to put the plug in. We were just out at Faith Haven, and I don't know if you were on the shore when this was happening. There was boats coming back and forth across Eagle Lake, and there was a pontoon that drove by that was so full of people that if we put Adeline on it, the boat would have taken water on it. Like the platform of this pontoon would have just come. What do you do when the boat is that low? You just, nobody move. Matter of fact, you stop breathing. Like, do not move an inch. Like, we are so close to taking water off. And here, the boat is full of fish. Like, no, I need to get to this part. So you're trying to wrangle. You could just walk across the ocean, but now it's full of fish. So you have to stop moving like that. You're bringing water. I can't help. And so they're slowly trying to get back to shore with this incredible catch. Right? And it's professional fishermen. They know what large catches look like. Verse 9. Peter and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. This is a catch unlike anything they've ever seen. And what happens here is Simon comes to the realization that the man he's called Master is now addressed as Lord. Catching fish should not convict you of sin. And yet that's what happens with Simon Peter. He comes back and addresses Jesus to get away from him, because he's a sinful man. And then he recognizes him as Lord. Not just master, but Lord. This man is more than a craftsman. He's more than just a pop-up rabbi. I'm a simple man. What is it that makes him convinced that he, like, why would he just say, thanks so much for the catch? This is incredible. Instead, he says, you need to leave me alone. I can't be around you. You're much greater than I am. You're doing things that I can't believe. And at this point, I think Jesus, like, classic Simon, you know? What does Jesus say here? Take a look at your Bibles. In verse 10. Jesus says to Simon, do not be afraid. That's always the first thing that's said in the Bible when people have an encounter with a divine being. Angel shows up. People freak out, fall on the ground. The first thing that's always said, do not be afraid. That's what Jesus says here. Jesus, the man who's just helped them catch this incredible load of fish, Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men. It's funny how much God kind of just takes whenever we say no and just brings us into something greater than we ever imagined. Like, I just think of my own testimony where coming through college, about to graduate, maybe a few months left to go, and Hannah and I are engaged at this point. We're getting ready to get married in August, and she had the line of, you ever think about seminary? Nope. Don't want to. That's the place you go when you want to be a pastor, a head pastor at a church. And I don't necessarily want that. I want to work with students. Well, you can work with students as a head pastor. Yeah, that's true. But I just, youth ministry seems to kind of be the zip code that I want to be in. And there's all these things that come with being a pastor that I don't feel prepared for or want to do. Guess what? That September, after we're married, we're heading up to Duluth with some friends, and I'm running through the Greek alphabet to try and practice and get at least a little head start, because classes start in a half a week. And then from there, on internship, all of a sudden we get a letter from you guys. Hey, you want to come be our pastor? And at that point, I remembered what Gideon Johnson had said about the Dalton Parish, about there being three churches. Because he had been here during the summer, right, when Pastor Brett had moved down to Shakopee. He came back and told us about this parish that had three churches, and it seemed that the people were great and all this, and he was just this great report about what was going on in the Dalton Parish, and we just, well, three churches seems like a interesting way to live your life, to do ministry. And then we got a letter from you guys, and we didn't say no, but we was like, you guys. And the more we talked, and the more with Pastor Mark, and Kurt Mortensen, and all the other people that were on the call committee at that time, the more we talked, the more it was, okay, yeah. And this is what happens when Jesus, and I realize that I'm young here by a margin, still the youngest pastor you have. But it's this thing that, when you're following Jesus, all of a sudden you're going this way, right? And you're not expecting to go this way. And Jesus has so much more for your life than you ever thought possible. So many greater things happen when you follow Jesus. You shouldn't be surprised when God answers prayers in ways that you don't expect. But we are. Because I think prayer should be answered this way. I think this should happen. And Jesus says, yeah, there's what you're used to, right? And this is what he says to Simon Peter. You're used to this. Don't be afraid, right? Don't be afraid, Simon. From now on, you'll be catching men. This is the way you're used to working, Simon. Here's what you're going to do. Your reliance upon yourself, what you can do, is the invitation when Jesus calls to give that up and to rely solely on him. Give up your pride. Give up your goals and ambitions. Is Jesus greater than what you have set in mind for what you want to accomplish with your life? Is Jesus greater than what's on your agenda this week? Serious question. It's a question everyone has to wrestle with. I can't answer that question for you. For me, yeah, you know what? As great as this trip is going to be for us this week, for the youth group, Jesus is still greater. Who knows what this week is going to entail? I mean, I have an agenda put out. We've got a rough plan of what's going to happen, but we're going to play it kind of fast and loose. If the weather turns south, we've got games. We've got things we can do at the cabin. Mark Schoening also lent us the jet ski. So, yeah, we're going to have a blast. Is Jesus greater? Absolutely. Here's what you're used to life being. Might Jesus have something greater in store? I think right now we have a lot of people that like to compartmentalize Jesus into just one little section of their life. We'll give Jesus the guest house. It's nice that he's here. He's great company. He's great to be able to talk to when we need it. But he can be over there and do his own thing. I'm going to continue to do my thing. That tends to be the attitude that people have with Christianity. It's lukewarm Christianity. It stops on the power of God. It just says, no, we like Jesus, but we like him over there. And I've mentioned before how much I like C.S. Lewis, but he writes, and he's great with word pictures, but he has this great line here, and I want to read this. Imagine yourself as a living house. Got it? Imagine yourself as a house. God comes in to rebuild that house. Who doesn't like a good fixer-upper show? Right? We're going to overhaul your kitchen, and your bathroom's a mess, but we're going to put in new floors and the lighting, and we'll repaint and do some landscaping. It'll be great. So imagine yourself as a living house. God comes in to rebuild that house. At first, perhaps, you can understand what he's doing. He gets the drains right and stops the leaks in the roof and so on. You knew those jobs needed doing, so you're not surprised. But presently, he starts knocking the house about in a way that hurts abominably and does not seem to make any sense. What on earth is he up to? The explanation is that he is building quite a different house from the one you thought of. He's throwing out a new wing here. He's putting on an extra floor there. He's running up towers. He's making courtyards. You thought you were being made into a decent little cottage. But he is building a palace. And he intends to come and live in it himself. Isn't that great? We have this idea of it's nice to have Jesus there. It's nice if he just stays, we draw a circle around him, if he stays there. We'll come to him if we want, but he's kind of like the ringer that we keep on the bench during the game. Right? We'll call on him if we really need to, but we're pretty self-sufficient. We like being able to do things, and that's not what happens here. As the master calls the disciples, Jesus is calling Simon Peter to give up that reliance on yourself, what you're able to do, and to rely solely on him. Give all of that up. Think about what Simon has. He has a small fortune on his hands with this catch. As soon as they get back into to the shore, what happens? He leaves everything and goes and follows Jesus. All that money he could have made from that fish, I mean, he could have been cleaning those fish for days. He could have paid off his boats. He could have hired some new help. He might have been able to buy some new fishing nets and some fancy gear to help him later on. He could have made some serious investments with all of this money. And I'm gonna follow the guy who gave me this catch in the first place. That's what Simon Peter does. And it's a lesson of obedience. Simon Peter obeys initially, not convinced of who Jesus is, not sure of who he is at all, period. And through that small act of obedience, Jesus shows himself and what he's able to do. And just this little way, and in almost a sense here, right? As Jesus starts calling the disciples in the Gospel of John, he's like, you're impressed at these little miracles? Like, when he calls Nathanael to follow him, he says, well, I saw you while you while you were sitting under this tree. Nathanael was alone at this point when the other disciples said, hey, come and meet this guy. Could he be the Messiah? And Nathanael said, well, we'll see. And Jesus told him what he had been doing without having any knowledge of it. And Nathanael's impressed. You're the Son of God. And Jesus, you're impressed by that? Just wait, pal. You're in for a ride. You're going to see so much more. You're going to see so much greater things. We have to have our lives reflect what it means to follow Jesus. When we live in obedience to him, you know what it looks like to follow Jesus? How can people know if we're following Jesus? Jesus tells us in the Gospel of John, by our love for one another. How are we doing on that? Self-conviction question as well. Because it's easy to love people like Jesus. Jesus is easy to love. Even someone like Simon Peter, classic Simon, we can love him, not a problem. Christianity tells us to love Judas. And that's a problem. You don't like that. Judas betrays. Judas hurts. Judas stabs in the back. Judas steals from us. Judas makes life difficult. Judas tries to undermine us everywhere we go. And yet, Jesus still loves Jesus and Judas. He doesn't kick Judas out. He knows what Judas is doing. He knows what Judas is going to do. And yet Jesus tells us to love our enemies and to pray for people that would hurt us. That's how people know that we're the followers of Jesus. That's how people know that he's the Lord of our life, that we live in obedience to him even when it's hard. And our younger people now need to see that we actually take our faith seriously and that church isn't just something we practice on Sunday mornings. They need to see us living this out. They need to know what God has done in your life as well. I'm kind of soapboxing here. There's this element of youth ministry and student ministry that I'm going to ask you guys something here, and I can do this because none of our students are here this morning. I'm going to invite you to come and tell your story at some point. Just come and talk to the kids. It doesn't have to be fancy or long or anything that are complicated, or you don't have to have flannel graph or anything like that. You just come and share. Get to know our kids. Get to know them a little bit. I think you're going to be surprised. I think you're going to be surprised at how many of them are actually genuinely interested to see what it looks like to follow Jesus in whatever you've been brought through in your life. I'm going to do that. So if I approach you and ask you and invite you to come do it, just be praying about it. You don't have to say yes. But I am going to come and ask. Because we need to be sharing what it looks like to obey Jesus. We need to show not just one another, but people coming after us, right? I'm just reminded of this this last week as we celebrated 150th. As we pass our faith on to the people who come after us, this legacy, how do we pass this legacy on? We incorporate them into this as much as we can in ways that they are interested to help. We just tell the story of what God has done. And just continue to be obedient to what Jesus says here to Simon Peter. From now on, you're going to be catching them. You've got a greater work ahead of you than anything you imagined. So, Lord, we need help in that work. As we pray week after week, we need you to strengthen us in this. Because sometimes following you is not that easy or enjoyable. Lord, it's always worth it. We don't always see that in the moment, so help us this week with what is in store. Lord, we pray that you would continue to work through us as we share and as we work as messengers in your kingdom. Lord, give us strength again into this week and encourage us for today. Continue to give us the rest we need. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we close our service today, let's sing 479 together. Hymn 479. Thank you. shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father,